Well, we're going to introduce a groundwater model and talk a little bit about how groundwater moves beneath the earth when it's out of sight. And our groundwater model is here. We've got a valley with a river flowing through it, or a stream. Downstream is toward me, and it drains through a tube into a basin on the floor. As you come across the valley, you would naturally come to a mountain, and we've eliminated the mountain to make the model reasonable in size, but we've stored the water that's under the mountain in a jar, and we're going to feed it through this feed tube on the side and allow the water to move from there across the valley through the aquifer and make its way to the stream. We can detect the movement of that water by injecting some dye. We add it here, and it will show up as a spot at that point. So this is just green food coloring, and I'm injecting it with a syringe. So as you can see, we've added dye here, and the purpose of that is to allow us to visualize water movement through the model. And so the water that comes from under the mountain and flows across the valley is carrying the dye, and it forms a streamline. And you can see that it's exiting over here into the stream. At this point, I'm going to create a spill. It's by adding more green food coloring at this location, and it's going to represent a point source of pollution. Let me tell you a story as that's entering the ground. I had a call from a family in Pennsylvania, and they wanted to know how you get petroleum gasoline out of your drinking water. And I was kind of curious of how you get it in your drinking water. And the story was, they had been clearing snow from their driveway and ran out of fuel. So they refueled the snowblower and set the can down on the snowbank and finished clearing the driveway, put the snowblower away, and forgot about the gas can. So the next day the sun came out and melted snow and tipped the gas can over, and it leaked, and that was the source of petroleum in their water supply. So this point source that we've just created could be something, an accident, something like that. And what I want to do now is trace where the water table is in this model. So we can locate that by using the observation wells. I'm going to add a little bit of red food coloring to one of the observation wells so to help us find the water table easily. So I'll just add a drop, and then I'll wash it down with some water, and when it settles back down, it will settle to the water table level. And then I'm going to mark some points on the water table. The first one is at the water level under the mountain, which is at this water level right here, and we'll put a mark there. And the second one is at this water level where we just added the red dye. We'll put a mark there. And the third one is at this observation well with the green water, and we'll mark that level right here. And the last one is the water level in the stream, and we'll mark that right here. And now I'll put a smooth line through those, and that will describe the water table.
Go ahead, do what you need to do, Tom. I'll just edit that out.
And that shows us the location of the water table. And we need to be the water table, we can find it in reality by digging a hole. The hole will be empty until we reach the water table, and if we dig further below the water table, it will fill up with water. That's what these observation wells are showing us. We have a pumping well, drinking water well, located right here, and I'm going to add a pump to that well, just a syringe. This represents the pump, and we'll extract some water from that well. And I usually like to ask the audience what color water they expect to find, and often they're divided. It'll either be green or it'll be clear, and so we'll pull a little bit out and see what happens. And here we're getting green water immediately. So our point source has drifted down and across the aquifer and has reached the well, and the well is heavily contaminated, as we can see by the green color in the syringe. I'm going to get rid of that water. That went into the basin, which is collecting all of the outflow water from this well. And I'm going to install the pump again, and I'm going to pump one more time. And this time I want you to observe these observation wells and see what happens to the water level in those as we extract water from this well. And you should be able to see the observation water levels drop, and that indicates that this water table changes shape and it doesn't remain more or less horizontal. It forms a cone of depression around the well, drops toward the well. And you may be able to see the dye from the point source has dropped to the well and sort of outlines that cone of depression. So we've shown that pollution moves, or groundwater moves, slowly. In fact, let me describe how slowly it moves. When we first started this model, it took about a half an hour to move the dye from here to the exit point, which is a little bit more than a foot long. So if we make it a foot in half an hour, that's 2 feet an hour, that's about 50 feet a day. And that is in the range that groundwater typically moves, is 50 to 100 feet per day. There's one or two more things that we can learn from this groundwater model. You can see that our streamline ends at the stream, and this plume of contamination is moving toward the stream and will be intercepted and collected by the stream. So if we have a contamination event, usually it stays between the mountaintop and the stream. Water flows from the mountain to the stream. If we had a second mountain over here, which we typically would, that water would be flowing from that mountain toward the stream. And so a pollution event ends at the stream and stays, since the water starts to flow toward the stream at the mountaintop, it stays between the mountaintop and the ridge. And so one way to illustrate that is to ask a question. This is my well, and it's been contaminated. You have a friend who has a well on this side of the stream over here, and they are concerned about this contamination event that got my well. Will theirs be contaminated? And the best answer is no, it will stop at the stream. So unless something unusual happens, such as a drought that dries up the stream, this contamination will not be pulled to the other side. Those are the things that we can readily learn from this groundwater model. This model is a physical representation of a three-dimensional drawing made by EPA a few years ago. And its parts are, the aquifer is down here at the bottom, and it has a ridge line right at this location here, and the water table is represented by this blue covering, and it slopes toward from the ridge line to the stream, which is right at this location where the aquifer meets the wall of the model. And the ridge divides and water flows the opposite way on the other side of the ridge. What this allows us to see is we have a well represented by this dowel rod, and when we withdraw water from a well, we know that the water level drops around the well. So if we push on the rod and sink it down, we can form a cone of depression around this well and see that the water table is depressed in all directions, but more so in the uphill direction. And in fact, if we traced the depressed area of the water table on top of this membrane, we would come up with an area that looks something like this in shape. And this is the circular part of the cone of depression, and it extends all the way up the hill to the ridge line then. And if we bring that from where we drew it to the ground surface and centered it around the well, then this is the recharge area for the well, and it also then represents the area that needs to be protected from anything that we don't want to drink. So we will be limit the application of fertilizers and pesticides, and we'll try real hard not to have things stored that might be spilled, such as gasoline, and it's probably not the best place to burn trash, that sort of thing. So this is our area where we try very hard to protect what happens so that the water going through there will be as clean as possible and we get the highest quality water possible from this well as we pump water from the well. Our purpose here is to show you how to put together a model, something like this, which is a physical representation of a three-dimensional drawing made by EPA to show how groundwater moves around in the neighborhood of a well. And so we need a base to set it on and some side pieces to hold our groundwater model in. We need a groundwater base model, which we're going to cover with just a simple swimming cap. We start with just a piece of styrofoam and end with something like this. The other parts are the end walls, and they are shaped a little bit to match the curve of the top, and so they will go there. And we need one more piece to support the plexiglass cover at the top, and of course we need that plexiglass cover, and this can be heat formed at 300 degrees, and then I simply put, before I cut this opening out, I just laid a piece of aluminum foil over the top and then laid the warm plexiglass over the top of that and held it in place until it cooled to get its shape. You do have to be careful. If I was testing and got distracted for about an hour, and 300 degrees at an hour gives you a piece of plexiglass that's no longer clear. So you do have to be careful of that. 300 degrees for about 5 to 10 minutes is sufficient to get it warm enough to form over a shape like that. The starting point for this was a drawing of that, the shape of the aquifer, and I was able to cut that shape with a bread knife and slice it. The interior part of this, you can make an opening, and you can saw it out with a serrated knife or saw it out with a coping saw. Smoothing this so that you don't have little pieces of styrofoam flying around, I was able to do that with some coarse sandpaper, and I was able to smooth out the round part with just a sanding drum. So those were the tools. I guess one other thing, the plexiglass can be scored with a utility knife and snapped along a line to cut it to the size that you need. The final thing would be the well is just a dowel rod, and it should be rounded at the end so that it's blunt but has no sharp edges so that you don't perforate the swimming cap. So that is the parts, and it was all just put together with screws. This plexiglass drills with just ordinary drill bits for steel. you do need to be careful and drill pilot holes and then enlarge them with other drills, and don't advance the drill very rapidly. Allow it to spin and build up some heat so that it sort of melts as well as cuts its way through the plexiglass. If you drill too aggressively, it can catch and then crack the plexiglass. So there are more details available along with a model that has all the dimensions on it on the website listed below.